Welcome to Alternate Endings.
Half audiobook.
Half podcast.
Full apocalypse.
New episodes every Monday.
Start your week considering how everything could come to an end.
This story is titled Terror Adrift and was written and narrated by our very own Ivan Wayne.
That's me.
"Did you see that?" Beth asked. Her heart fluttered. She glimpsed a flash through the trees behind George. They were standing on his porch, her dress swaying in the breeze. Beth's heart had already rambled around in anticipation of kissing him. They had kissed twice before, and she hoped tonight may bring her lucky number 3. He wore a nice suit that night, made her feel like the luckiest girl in town. Maybe she was. "What?" George said, without looking behind him. "Fireworks or something. Through the trees?" It was a bright flash of orange light. George sighed, setting his cap on his head. "It's November. Nobody's going to be lighting fireworks. What do you think they're doing, celebrating Turkey Day by hooping and hollering like it's the nation's birthday?" "I doubt that."
"Well, I saw something, that's for sure."
"I know what I saw, George."
"It'll be no time and you'll claim there were lights all over the sky in the shape of a turkey."
"I know what I saw," Beth said. She crossed her arms, angered and nervous. She saw something pop through the tree branches just a few seconds prior, a bright light that must have been 200 yards away, over in the next neighborhood. It was a sharp flash of light, come and gone, in a breath.
"Are you going to be mad at me now?" George asked.
He reached out to touch Beth's elbow, but she backed away.
"You can be a real sore, George."
Beth began to step off the porch. She couldn't believe George thought she was lying, or crazy. They had gone out for supper, and she hoped to stay a bit and talk with him, maybe share a kiss, or several. Maybe wear a suit jacket over her dress and dance back and forth to some Bean Crosby on his front porch. That sounded quite nice. But now, she found herself wanting to go home, lock herself in a room, and forget this evening had ever happened in the first place. Or maybe she could just rewind time right before the flash through the forest, and she never would have to say anything to George. But then Beth supposed she would still be mad at the lumphead for mocking her. George called after her.
"Beth, where are you going?"
"Home," she said, without turning around. "I'm walking home." Before George could ask anything else, he noticed something up in the sky. If it weren't for the lights of the houses illuminating the bottom of the floating object against the deep backdrop of the night sky, he never would have seen it. The object drifted slowly sideways, about 100 feet off the ground. Several ropes dangled from the balloon and a dark object suspended beneath the pale orb. It was the oddest thing George had ever seen.
"Beth," he called out.
George could shove off. Maybe he should just go off in the war anyway. Go help our troops. The Germans were already surrendering here and there, so who knew if the war would even still be active when George turned 18 in a few months.
"Elizabeth."
"What?" she said, spinning around. She noticed George was gaping upwards like a starving baby bird. She chuckled before looking up for herself. He had just looked so preposterous. She spotted the large white orb floating directly above her, moving slowly down the street in the subtle winds. Her mind must have been playing tricks on her now. The flash of light, and now this? But George could see this too. Perhaps there was something in that milkshake they got at Larry's drive-in earlier. Maybe they Roombaed one too many songs and the music was now getting in their heads. Beth's mom would just die and have a cow if she knew her Elizabeth had been out dancing the Roomba with a boy from school that evening. Beth had only just wanted to escape all the war talk for one day. All the thoughts about the war, what country was being invaded next, how our boys were doing great against the Germans, people dying left and right, how Paris had been liberated and saved, the constant radio chatter about what was happening next. She knew George turned 18 in just a few months, and then he would probably get drafted too, off into the battle. To say she loved George would be too much, but he was the nicest boy in school. George was the best guy she had gone steady with yet. She had dated two of the other boys at their school, but they just weren't like George. She hoped the war was coming to an end, and tonight was supposed to be her sweet escape. And yet, now, here she stands in George's driveway, watching a giant, she hated to say it, but a giant balloon floating through the neighborhood. The air was so quiet, She could hear the house next door playing that Mills Brothers song. That song was the absolute tune these days. And she found herself thinking about George going away each and every single time she listened to that song. It said, "We always hurt the ones we love." She really hoped that wasn't true, because if anyone was going to get hurt sometime soon, it would surely be Beth. The large white balloon drifted above the houses as if coasting on the slightest of a breeze. "George, what is that?"
"I don't know, Elizabeth."
She spun, tracking the balloon with her eyes. It must have been the size of 2 or 3 cars, and there were long ropes hanging down from the balloon. They swung left and right, slightly bouncing with the changing winds. She heard footsteps approach behind her, and George grabbed her hand. "Come on, it's moving. Let's see where it's going."
"But what is it?"
She knew what he would say before he even responded.
"It's a balloon, Beth. A massive balloon floating over our neighborhood. How about that?"
"Is there anyone under it, you think?" she asked.
Beth couldn't quite tell what was underneath the balloon, but there didn't seem to be a basket for people to ride in. There wasn't any flame either, no noise, so this wasn't a hot air balloon. She thought of the flash she had seen just moments before. The speed of the balloon convinced Beth the two things could not be related. This balloon was slowly drifting and couldn't have skipped over the entire forest in seconds. George spoke as they ran down the street.
"I don't know. It's getting closer to the ground, I think." He was pulling Beth to keep up with him, and it made her smile.
"Come on, let's follow it."
It was dark outside, and Beth wasn't sure if she should be running around town with George this late. What if someone saw them? Would they talk about her at school, or would her dad hear about it down at his factory? Would her mother hear of her oldest daughter running around town at night with this George fella? Perhaps they wouldn't care in the midst of the booming news of the war and death of the day. She didn't know. Redding, California could always surprise you. However, she did know one thing. She liked the way George's hand felt in hers, and the balloon up above was enough to draw her mind from anything else in the world. Its solid majesty won her over and seemed to calm her. The balloon began to drop more, and the wind changed direction. Beth could feel the wind shift, whistling past her face and through her hair. Besides the trees rustling around people's houses, nothing made a sound. This balloon had to be as big as a house, or more, and it seemed to be silently swimming through the sky, dropping in elevation with each passing moment. The closer the balloon got to the ground, the bigger it seemed. This had to be the biggest balloon Beth had ever seen. Her family had gone to see a hot air balloon launch when she was a little kid, but she wasn't sure if this balloon beat her childhood memory or not.
"What's underneath the balloon, George?"
"I don't know."
"Is it going to hit that house?"
"Maybe so," George said. They both stopped running, and eventually they were standing still. 2 houses down across the street was a 2-story dark blue house. Beth walked by this house every time she would make her way to George's house. The front porch swing sometimes held some of the kids who lived there, a rambunctious group of little ones. She would imagine living in the navy blue house with its white shutters from time to time. Maybe she and George could share a house like that someday. Not that exact home, of course, but something like it. The balloon stopped for a moment before gliding down at an angle. The object underneath looked smaller than a person, but Beth had no idea what it was. The balloon itself was a pale white, lit up by the house lights and the partial moon in the sky. The ropes dangling off the balloon and the object below were all darker and sort of indescribable. The only word that came to mind for the package beneath the balloon was chandelier. But Beth wasn't about to say that. Not in front of George, anyway.
"George, it's going to land on that house."
"I know," he said. Neither of them laughed. She felt a shred of fear creep into her chest. She began to feel like she should be further from the cute blue house she so often walked past.
"What's going to happen?"
George did not answer. Beth looked at him and noticed his worried expression. The fear she had felt was not unique, and she squeezed George's hand. As the gap between the balloon and the house closed, Beth held her breath. George squeezed her hand back. They anticipated this giant balloon to flop onto the house and startle everyone inside. Instead, this balloon never made it to the house. As the object underneath the balloon touched the rooftop of the house Beth often dreamed of inhabiting herself, an explosion shook the neighborhood and the town forever. Beth screamed, and both George and her dropped to the ground. Chunks of the house bounced into the street, wood planks rolling and clanging into other people's yards. A large fire erupted from the side of the 2nd story. Beth didn't understand. The balloon. Was it carrying a bomb?
As the explosion and resulting fire consumed the house, the balloon took off back into the night. Beth began shaking her head. She was confused and shaken. George's eyes never left the blaze. The crackling house fire filled the street with light and noise. A few people came out of their houses. Beth thought she heard some screaming. She turned to George. "Should we do something? There's kids in there." "You think we should?" he said, looking over at Beth. This time it was Beth who led George, pulling him into the street. They navigated smoldering bits of wood and random pieces of the house strewn about. Beth worried about nails and glass, hoping her shoes would suffice. As they reached the other side of the street, more neighbors were outside, everyone staring at the house like lost children. None of them had seen the balloon. For all they knew, this house spontaneously combusted, raining burnt shrapnel onto their lawns. George and Beth stared at the house as the fire enveloped the entire side of the building where the balloon kissed and said its goodbye. One of the kids from next door ran over to George. Two other children of similar ages followed suit, and the three little kids sought shelter behind George and Beth as they marveled at the flames licking out of the devastated home. "What's that?" one of the kids said. Beth didn't turn around, trying to ignore them. She was contemplating running in and seeing if anyone was home or if the family needed help. Nobody ran out of the front of the house yet. She was worried for the little ones that she had seen so many times before on the porch swing that was now beginning to catch fire.
"Whoa, what is it?"
another kid replied, behind Beth.
"It's a giant balloon,"
the young girl spoke up.
"It's a big balloon."
Beth turned around and peered upward to see if the children were seeing the balloon dropping back down. Without saying anything, she gripped George's hand really tight.
"George."
As he turned around, they both noticed something they wished were not true.
"That's another balloon. Look."
Below the large white orb dangled another dark chandelier. The rope swung to and from, guiding the deathly balloon to its random dropping point of fiery anguish. Beth looked across the street at a dad and his son. They were looking up in the sky, but they were pointing in another direction. They were pointing up the street, away from this second balloon. Beth followed their gaze and saw for herself a third balloon. She shook George's arm and pointed herself. He turned back around.
"What?" he said, as his eyes landed on what she saw.
A third balloon was carrying the same exact shape, a bomb ready to explode upon impact.
"Oh my God," Beth said.
Beyond the third balloon, she noticed a fourth in the distance. She could barely see its ghostly orb shape, but there was no mistake. The ground rumbled and the children screamed. Another explosion on the next street over. Orange and yellow light bolted through the houses and backlit the homes, lucky enough to not be on fire just yet.
"How many of them are there?"
"At least," George paused. "The ones I can see now?" He turned around, making a full scan of the nighttime surrounding them. "Counting the one that just landed one street over, I have seen 6 in all."
"What do we do?"
Beth asked. Screams came from behind them.
"My baby! My baby!"
A woman was stumbling out of the navy blue house, a child laid in her arms. No one else accompanied her. Beth knew at least 5 people lived there. She wanted to run over and help the woman, ask if she could do anything. As she began to pull George with her, another explosion rocked the street underneath their feet. This explosion occurred in the middle of the road, and the balloon dropped alongside the explosion. The balloon material caught on flame and burnt, lighting up the entire block. It might as well be daylight by this point. The amount of light flickering around the different sides of each home, and the intense heat pouring through the neighborhood. Beth looked at George. They stared at one another, both of them out of breath.
"Let's get back to my house," Beth pleaded.
"What about her?"
She looked at the direction of the mom, now doubled over her child. They were in the front yard, the blaze not too far behind them. Flames picked up behind them as a balloon slid into another row of trees. There was no explosion, but the entire grouping of trees was instantly aflame. The balloon dangled over the edges of trees, soon to be nothing but ash. George yelled over the sound of houses and trees burning.
"There are too many balloons falling. We have to get to safety."
"Safety? A house is not safe," Beth said. "Did you not see what happened to them?"
"I don't know, Beth."
"I don't either."
"Come on," George said. "I have an idea."
He led Beth through the children, who were still gathered behind them, peering around the bigger adults at the house ablaze. The couple ran down the middle of the street, scanning rooftops and directly above them for the next balloon that may bring fire and hell upon them.
"Wait," Beth said, pulling George to a stop. "Are we going to your house?"
"Yeah," George said, looking confused.
"What about my family?" Beth asked. She looked around and heard sirens off in the distance. Then, another explosion. This time, much further away. "I need to see if my family is okay." George spoke, removing his cap, slipping his hair back.
"I do too."
"All right," Beth said. "What was your idea?"
"Get out of here. Leave. Take the car. Get outside of Reading."
Beth looked above, scanning for another orb carrying a deadly package. She paused, seeing two balloons drifting side by side hundreds of feet above. George looked up, seeing them for himself. The two suspended balls of pale white looked so peaceful and serene. They seemed to hold hands in the twilight. Beth brought her attention back down to George. "What if these balloons are everywhere? Leaving here won't help."
"They all seem to be drifting into this area. I was hoping we could get out of their path. Maybe there are less balloons in a certain direction from here.
We won't know if we don't try, Beth." She began to tear up.
"But what are they? What is going on? Is this something to do with the war? Is this the Germans?"
George held both of her hands. "Listen, go and check on your family. See who is around and if everyone is okay. I'll do the same. Then I'll bring the car over. We can't come through here, so I'll take Dawson Street around the block. I'll honk when we are outside, and then we can get out of here. Our families, everyone together."
"Do you think it'll work?"
Beth said, shaking George's hands back and forth.
"I do not know, but I'm not staying here. Look around us, Elizabeth. Any house, including the ones our families are in, could be the next one."
The two of them looked down the street one way, seeing a house aflame. Two balloons laid out in the street, their tarps waving a forlorn goodbye to anyone who cared to witness. Looking the other direction, trees and lawns were on fire. People ran down the sidewalk, checking on neighbors and family. Cries and yelling could be heard intermittently throughout the community, just now falling to its knees.
"Elizabeth."
She snapped her attention back to where they stood on the street corner, a tear rolling down her cheek.
"Elizabeth, get to your house. Gather your family. I'll be there soon, and we will get out of here. Everything is going to be okay."
"How can you say that, George?"
She wiped her cheek.
"It's not okay for her, that mom from the house, or these people whose home is on fire?"
George hugged her. Beth wasn't sure, but she thought she could feel him trembling. Maybe he was cold. November was settling in, and in Northern California, that meant a slight drop in temperatures had already begun. Maybe he was scared of what was happening, or perhaps this made him think about what war would really be like, and that he would soon have to face wartime himself. She did not know the answer, and she didn't think to ask. He whispered without letting her go,
"I'm scared too, Beth. But let's get out of here with our families. Let's hope things are better elsewhere. We cannot stay here."
"I agree," she said.
She released him, and as they pulled away, she kissed him without a hesitation. It wasn't the third kiss she imagined with George, but it was enough to get her running all the way around the entire world if she had to. Another explosion rocketed through the night air, this time much closer.
"Honk when you arrive. We will be ready with our car."
"You got it," George said.
He smiled before turning towards his house. That slight smirk was all she needed to think everything just might be okay, that tomorrow maybe she would wake up and things would have a smile to them. She was satisfied George was here with her right now. What a boy he was. She hoped she would get to see him again, that he would be okay. But there was not time to think too much and lollygag about. Grabbing the sides of her dress, she began running down the street, retracing the path her and George had shared playfully just minutes ago. That seemed like a different world, far, far from here now. She looked across the street at the navy blue house. Nobody was in the front yard. No mourning mother, no child in her arms. The house was engulfed in flames, and the entire structure began to lean left and groan with pain. The porch swing was nothing but a distant memory amongst the seemingly random hatred falling from above. Beth dodged random bits of houses, careful not to step on anything hazardous. Looking to her left, she stopped running for a moment. Her mouth slipped ajar as her eyes fixated on a scene straight from her dreams. There were at least 20 visible balloons afloat in the night sky. Their pale white color beamed and flickered with the fires below. Beth knew they were all the same size, but their varying distance and height from the ground made them look very different from one another. All the balloons drifted in the same lazy fashion, moving laterally and gently falling. Remembering to look up, she glanced to ensure no balloons were descending down upon her. Several orbs were far above in the sky, but they would blow far past this neighborhood. Picking back up her pace, she realized for the first time that evening her home may have already been destroyed by a bomb-delivering object from the clouds. What if her parents didn't hear the first explosions and were inside when a balloon collided with their home? What if there would be nothing but flame and ash waiting for her when she arrived? These cyclical horrors in her mind's eye made her run faster, now sprinting down the street, letting her dress fly behind her. She had never wanted to see her house intact so bad before, verifying with her own senses that everything was A-okay. Her mind replayed that first explosion, George's hand locked in hers, and she couldn't help but see her own home now in the flames, the wood and metal buckling. The worst possible scenarios were also playing out in her mind. George not ever making it to his house, him being killed by an explosion or a fire, or possibly George never even made it to his house. Or what if he just left and never came back, throwing dust behind him and out of here for good? She clenched her fists as her breath ran short. Beth wasn't sure she had ever ran this fast. She might have been more proud of herself if the intense fear wasn't already strangling her to death. Rounding her street, she saw her house. Everything was normal. She sighed, relieved. Without ceasing to run, she slowed her pace. Nobody was outside, but the lights in the house were on. No cars in the driveway? No fire, no bombs, no chandeliers? But wait, if there were no cars, that meant neither of her parents were home. Her feet picked up pace again, and her mind raced even faster. Barreling into her front room, nearly unable to speak, she scanned the house. Mom? Dad? She walked through the living room and into the kitchen. All the lights were on. Michael? But no one was home. Thinking of upstairs, she ascended the staircase in what felt like a single bounce. Dad? Anybody? No responses. She could hear fires burning outside, and the flickering of flames were visible each time she passed a window. Mom? Without reason or restraint, Beth began to sob. She slumped her way back downstairs, looking around her house. Beth had to clear her eyes more than once in order to see if anyone was home. Anyone? Is anyone home? She thought to look outside in her backyard. Walking out the back door, she found an empty yard, empty of anybody. Had they all left? Where were they? The house was fine, but the cars were missing. Why did they leave? No sign of damage, no fire, no balloons on the house or around it. Her mind ran circles, like a dog chasing its tail. Beth jumped as an explosion rocked the ground and vibrated through her chest. The amber glow lit up the left side of her face and danced through her eyes. It could not have been further than 2 or 3 houses down. Screams made their way through the fences, and Beth searched the sky for the next surprise to drop. She saw 3 balloons in the sky above her. One was relatively close, but judging by its direction and speed, Beth figured it would miss her house. The other 2 bulbs of silent death were high enough in the sky. It would be a very long time before they either crashed into the ground, falling to a death of napalm and smoke, or gently dropping destruction on the surface before rising back into the night sky. Out of the corner of her eye, Beth glimpsed a very bright object. Whew! Just the moon. She chuckled and wiped her face again. It's just the moon, and not even a full moon at that. Do not be silly, Beth, she told herself. Do not lose your head now. What was she to do? Where was her family? George was taking longer than she anticipated, and who knew where the next balloon would strike? She figured the best place to wait would be in the front yard. Beth would have better visibility for incoming balloons, and she could wait for George. There wasn't much else she could do. What could anyone do? She didn't even know what was happening. Looking down at her ruffled dress, she smoothed her hands over the front of it, sliding down her stomach and legs. This was her favorite dress. Depending on how the night proceeded from here, she might have to consider this her lucky dress from now on. Multiple honks alarmed through the house, echoing off its empty walls. Beth ran, glancing around once more to see if anyone was home. Nobody. Shuffling out the front door, she saw 2 cars. Confused, she stopped. "Hurry up, Elizabeth," her mom screamed. "Get in George's car." The car in front was George. He was driving. His younger brother sat next to him. The other car included Beth's mom and her younger brother, Michael. She ran up to her mom's car. "We went looking for you, went to George's house, wanted to find you and make sure you were safe. Thank God you're okay." "Yeah, I'm okay, Mom." She noticed her mom's hair and makeup were perfect, her pearl earrings and necklace in tow. Her mom looked either overprepared for an apocalypse or like she was ready to deliver a speech at the next PTA meeting. You take your pick. Then again, Beth's mom was always that way. Okay, Elizabeth, listen to me. A flash of fire lit up behind her mother, seated in the car, outlining her profile. Listen, her mom said again. She had always been a woman of few words and fewer emotions, and she did not show any signs that she had been crying. Beth's lip quivered as another tear fell onto the street. Your father is at work, or he was. I am going to check on him. You and Michael go with George. We will all meet up in Orland. George's mom seems to think there were less balloons down south. Okay? Okay, Beth said. She stepped back, allowing Michael to step out of the car. He reached for Beth's hand. She forgot her dad was at work that evening. The thought had skipped her mind completely in the midst of everything. She felt ashamed for not remembering. Her mom continued. You are going south. Orland. I will find your father, and then we will meet you at Gerald's General Store. All right? Yes, Mom, Beth said. She patted Michael's hand, oblivious she was moving at all. Michael seemed more confused than anything. You all go with George and his brother. We will meet you there, I promise. George's General Store. Do we need anything from inside the house? Heavens no, Elizabeth. Nothing in there we can't just buy again. The world is ending and my Elizabeth is worried about our stuff in the house. Beth looked around, shrugging off her mother's comment. Michael? Her mom said. You and your sister are going to be just fine. Your father and I will see you soon in Orland. Just make sure to avoid whatever those things are. They move slow enough. I love you both. And with that, the car spun around and was gone. Beth watched the car drive away, hoping she would get to see those taillights again. George grabbed her shoulder, pulling her toward his car. Come on, you two. We have to get a move on. My mom and two of my brothers are already gone. They died? Beth said, without moving her gaze from her mother's car. No, they're heading to Orland. They left before I ever got back home. Let's go. Beth took a few steps backwards before ducking down into the back seat. She did not want to let her eyes pull off the fading taillights of her mom's vehicle for some unnerving reason. Beth watched the car turn the corner and vanish, the same car she had learned to drive in. She hoped that that would not be the last time she would glimpse that sparkling green 42 Buick. Getting out of Reading was difficult and required several instances of intentional slowing down or speeding up in order to steer clear of a falling balloon. However, George noticed less and less balloons during their drive the further south they went. Once in Orland, looking to the south, they saw almost zero balloons in the sky. While waiting for her parents in the parking lot of Gerald's, Beth watched several of the balloons pass over them. With nothing to do but wait, she found herself wondering who sent these balloons. Why was this happening? Was it God? The Russians? The Germans? Where was Mom and Dad? She could not believe that George and her had chased the first balloon they saw that night. She considered herself very lucky they did not get themselves killed. Beth hoped that this would all make sense, but she did not know the days of normality were far behind her. While she was not aware at the time, Beth's last time she ever got to see her mother or that green Buick was when she watched her mom speed off that first night of the balloons. A bridge had been blown out by a bomb in between their neighborhood and her father's work in town. Another balloon was falling just hundreds of feet to her mother's left, pulling her eyes and attention from the road. Distracted, Beth's mom never noticed the bridge was out. She drove off into the river below, and that was that. Beth's dad waited for hours on his wife, watching the balloons drop and explode at the wind's discretion. The guys in the factory talked about the Japanese, the Germans, someone from the Axis powers, how some of them wished they could serve. Others were thankful to have got to stay home from the war. They talked big game about what to do next in the war, about this attack. The factory he worked for topped one of the tallest hills in Reading. With a good panorama view, Beth's father was forced to wait out and watch the mayhem consume his local community. Eventually, he drove to Gerald's General Store, hoping that his wife had gotten lost or maybe she was confused about the plan. When he arrived and his two children ran to him and asked where their mom was, reality began to sink its teeth into everyone. The next day, the FBI, the military, and the Office of Censorship of the United States arrived in Reading. For reasons Beth could not understand, people all over Northern California were being told not to say anything to anyone about balloons or anything about those nights. Radio stations were being silenced and threatened from saying anything related to bombs or balloons. Beth argued endlessly with her dad about this decision. Beth lost her mom, and now everyone was supposed to not talk about what they saw that night or the next night. Nobody was supposed to go to the press. But why? Her anger was rivaled only by her nervousness drummed up by the FBI and countless soldiers driving around her town for weeks. They were inspecting crash sites, assessing damage, interviewing people, and always reminding each and every person not to say a word to anyone about any bombs or any balloons. The entire area had become an imaginary war zone, with armed soldiers and suited men on every street safeguarding some secret disaster. The rebuilding from fires and explosions took years to fix. Nobody was ever directly told why this happened, if it was a war incident, an act of God, or anything. Beth did not know why the Office of Censorship and the FBI were heavily involved in the cover-up of this incident. Had this been something from the U.S. government? However, Beth was unaware that the tight secrecy which with the Hellfire balloons were treated is the only reason the balloons ever stopped coming. Stay tuned for next time, when we recap this story and discuss the lesser-known events of World War II that inspired this episode.
Thanks all for listening. Check out the next episode where we discuss and review this story. We hope to see you there, as long as the world doesn't end before then.
We would like to thank Kevin MacLeod for his music found on Incompetech.com.